Hello everyone. In this video, today we are going to discuss about urine formation and regulation. I am Dr. Aishwarya Balab. So we will start with the diuretics. What is mean by the diuretics and how urine formation will be affected by diuretics. So diuretics are chemicals that increase the rate of urine formation. By increasing the urine flow rate, diuretic usage leads to increased excretion of electrolytes, especially sodium and chloride ions, and water from the body without affecting protein, vitamin, glucose, or amino acid reabsorption. These pharmacologic properties have led to the use of diuretics in the treatment of edematous conditions, that is retention of excess fluid, resulting from a variety of causes, for example, congestive heart failure, nephrotic syndrome, and chronic liver disease, and in the management of hypertension. A diuretic is used when the patient shows signs of excess fluid retention. So we will first discuss the normal physiology of urine formation. Two important functions of the kidney are, first, to maintain a homeostatic balance of electrolytes and water, and second, to excrete water-soluble end products of metabolism. The kidney accomplishes these functions through the formation of urine by the nephrons. Each kidney contains approximately 1 million nephrons and is capable of forming urine independently. The nephrons are composed of a specialized capillary bed called the glomerulus and a long tubule divided anatomically and functionally into the proximal tubule, loop of Henle, and distal tubule. Each component of the nephron contributes to the normal functions of the kidney in a unique manner, thus all are targets for different classes of diuretic agents. This is the diagram of nephron, where you can see the blood supply to this glomerulus is by the afferent arterioles, and then the going back or the going out blood vessels will be efferent arteriole. This glomerulus is situated into the Bowman's capsule. After Bowman's capsule, the next part of the nephron is the proximal convoluted tubule, that is PCT, which then goes to the loop of Henle, which contains two parts, that is descending limb and ascending limb. And the next part is distal convoluted tubule, which goes to the end of the nephron, that is a collecting duct. And the blood circulation around this nephron is by the vasa recta. So, in this nephron, how the exchange of or reabsorption of ions or essential components will take place, that we will see. That is, this kidney is made up of three layers, that is cortex, outer medulla, and inner medulla. And this nephron is situated into these three parts. So here you can see this diagram where three parts are there and how the nephron is situated. So in cortex, mainly the PCT, that is proximal convoluted tubules, and DCT, distal convoluted tubules are situated. So in the outer medulla, the part of the loop of Henle, that is descending limb and ascending limb, is situated. And this middle part of the loop of Henle is situated into the inner medulla. So here you can see the there are two types of arrows, violet and red. Red will show you the active transport and violet will show you the passive transport. So in PCT or proximal convoluted tubule, you can see that there is the active transport of sodium chloride, other nutrients, and hydrogen ions will take place, whereas the passive transport of carbonate, water, and ammonia and potassium will take place. Whereas in this loop of Henle, there is first descending limb. In descending limb, there will be passive transport of water will be there, and in ascending limb, there is passive transport of sodium chloride as well as the active transport of sodium chloride will take place. Whereas in distal convoluted tubule, you can see that there is active transport of sodium chloride, potassium, hydrogen, and carbonate ions is taking place. Whereas passive transport of water will take place in the distal convoluted tubule. And in case of collecting duct, there will be active transport of sodium chloride, which will take place with the help of the aldosterone here. And the passive transport of urea and water will take place at the collecting duct. Urine formation begins with the filtration of blood at the glomerulus. Approximately 1200 ml of blood per minute flows through both kidneys and reaches the nephron by way of afferent arterioles. Approximately 20% of the blood entering the glomerulus is filtered into Bowman's capsule to form the glomerular filtrate. The glomerular filtrate is composed of blood components with a molecular weight less than that of albumin, that is less than 69,000 daltons, and not bound to plasma proteins. The glomerular filtration rate, GFR, averages 125 ml per minute in humans, but can vary widely even in normal functional states. The glomerular filtrate leaves the Bowman's capsule and enters the proximal convoluted tubule, where the majority, that is 50% to 60% of filtered sodium, is reabsorbed osmotically. Sodium reabsorption is coupled electrogenetically with the reabsorption of glucose, phosphate, and amino acids, and non-electrogenetically with bicarbonate reabsorption. Glucose and amino acids are completely reabsorbed in this portion of the nephron, whereas phosphate reabsorption is between 80% and 90% complete. The early proximal convoluted tubule also is the primary site of bicarbonate reabsorption, that is 80 to 90%, a process that is mainly sodium dependent and coupled to hydrogen ion secretion. So here you can see the at PCT or proximal convoluted tubule, mostly the glucose, phosphate, and amino acids will get reabsorbed along with your sodium ions, and also the bicarbonate ions will also get reabsorbed here. The reabsorption of sodium and bicarbonate is facilitated by the enzyme carbonic anhydrase, which is present in proximal tubular cells and catalyzes the formation of carbonic acid from water and carbon dioxide. The carbonic acid provides the hydrogen ion, which drives the reabsorption of sodium bicarbonate. Chloride ions are reabsorbed passively in the proximal tubule, where they follow actively transported sodium ions into the tubular cells. The reabsorption of electrolytes and water also occurs isosmotically in the proximal straight tubule or pars recta. By the end of the straight segment, between 65 and 75% of water and sodium chloride and calcium ions, 80 to 90% of bicarbonate and phosphate, and essentially 100% of glucose, amino acids, vitamins, and protein have been reabsorbed from the glomerular filtrate. So in PCT, all these components will be reabsorbed. The proximal tubule also is the site for active secretion of weakly acidic and weakly basic organic compounds. Thus, many of the diuretics can enter luminal fluid not only by filtration at the glomerulus but also by active secretion. The descending limb of the loop of Henle is impermeable to ions, but water can freely move from the luminal fluid into the surrounding medullary interstitium, where the higher osmolality draws water into the interstitial space and concentrates luminal fluid. So here you can see the descending loop of Henle. Here it is only permeable to the water. So only water will get exchanged or removed from the luminal fluid to the blood in the descending limb of the loop of Henle. Luminal fluid continues to concentrate as it descends to the deepest portion of the loop of Henle, where the fluid becomes the most concentrated. The hypertonic luminal fluid next enters the water impermeable thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle. In this segment of the nephron, approximately 20% to 25% of the filtered sodium and chloride ions are reabsorbed via a co-transport system on the luminal membrane. That is, sodium, potassium, and chloride ion exchange will take place. So in this thin and thick segment of this ascending limb, there will be exchange of sodium chloride ions will take place with the help of co-transport system. Reabsorption of sodium and chloride in the medullary portion of the thick ascending limb is important for maintaining the medullary interstitial concentration gradient. So in this medullary part, that is the thick part of the descending and ascending limb, here mainly it will maintain the concentration gradient. Reabsorption of sodium chloride in the cortical component of the thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle and the early distal convoluted tubule contributes to urinary dilution, and as a result these two nephron sections sometimes are called the cortical diluting segment of the nephron. So here in cortical part, that is thick ascending limb and also the starting part of this distal convoluted tubule, here mainly there will be the exchange of this sodium chloride will take place, or reabsorption of the sodium chloride will take place, due to which whatever the here in the end part of the or the middle part of the loop of Henle, the concentrated urine is formed that will get diluted in this portion. That's why it is called as the cortical dilating segment of the nephron. Luminal fluid leaving the early distal tubule next passes through the late distal tubule and cortical collecting tubule, that is collecting duct, where sodium is reabsorbed in exchange for hydrogen and potassium ions. So here you can see the in distal convoluted tubule, here the sodium will be reabsorbed in exchange of hydrogen and potassium. This process is partially controlled by mineral corticoids, for example aldosterone, and accounts for the reabsorption of between 2 to 3% of the filtered sodium ions. Although the reabsorption of sodium ions from these segments of the nephron is not large, this sodium potassium hydrogen ion exchange system determines the final acidity and potassium content of urine. Several factors, however, can influence the activity of this exchange system, including the amount of sodium ions delivered to these segments, the status of the acid-base balance in the body, and the levels of circulating aldosterone. The urine formed during this process represents only approximately 1 to 2% of the original glomerular filtrate, with more than 98% of electrolytes and water filtered at the glomerulus being reabsorbed during passage through the nephron. Thus, a change in urine output of only 1 to 2% could double urine volume. Urine leaves the kidney through the ureters and travels to the bladder, where it is stored until urination removes it from the body. Now, how this urine formation is regulated? Normally, the body contains several control mechanisms that regulate the volume and contents of urine. These systems are activated by changes in solute or water content of the body, by changes in systemic or renal blood pressure, and by a variety of other stimuli. Activation of one or more of these systems by diuretic drugs can modify the effectiveness of these drugs to produce their therapeutic response and may require additional therapeutic measure to ensure a maximal response. The kidney has the ability to respond to changes in the glomerular filtration rate through the action of specialized distal tubular epithelial cells called the macula densa. These cells are in close contact with the glomerular apparatus of the same nephron and detect changes in the rate of urine flow and luminal sodium chloride concentration. An increase in the urine flow rate at this site, as can occur with the use of some diuretics, activates the macula densa cells to communicate with the granular cells and vascular segments of the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Stimulation of the juxtaglomerular apparatus causes renin to be released, which leads to the formation of angiotensin II and subsequent renal vasoconstriction. Renal vasoconstriction leads to a decrease in GFR and possibly a decrease in the effectiveness of the diuretic. Renin release also can be stimulated by factors other than diuretics, including decreased renal perfusion pressure, increased sympathetic tone, and decreased blood volume. Another important regulatory mechanism for urine formation is antidiuretic hormone, ADH, also known as vasopressin, which is released from the posterior pituitary in response to reduced blood pressure and elevated plasma osmolality. In the kidney, ADH acts on the collecting tubule to increase water permeability and reabsorption. As a result, the urine becomes more concentrated and water is conserved in the presence of ADH. So after seeing this urine formation, now we will see the classification of diuretics. Depending on which ion they are excreting, this is the classification. That is natriuretic, which enhances the sodium excretion. Chloruretic, enhanced chloride excretion. Saluretic, enhanced sodium chloride excretion. Caluretic, enhanced potassium excretion. Bicarbonateuretic, enhanced sodium bicarbonate excretion. Calciuretic, enhanced calcium excretion. Another classification of diuretics is depending on their mechanism of action and the location of action. These are the classes of drugs of diuretics. First one, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Examples are brinzolamide, acetazolamide, dorzolamide. Second, loop diuretics. Examples are furosemide, bumetanide, torazemide, ethacrynic acid. Third class is thiazide diuretics. Examples are hydrochlorothiazide, clopamide, benzthiazide, chlorthalidone, metolazone, zipamide, indapamide. Fourth class is potassium sparing diuretics, in which again there are two subclasses. First one is aldosterone antagonist. Examples are spironolactone, canrinone, eplirone. Another subclass is direct acting. These are examples are triamcinolone, amiloride, which are more potent. And the next class of diuretics is osmotic diuretic. Examples are glycerin, urea, mannitol, and isosorbide. So this diagram will provide the different locations where these type of diuretics will act and what will be the mechanism by which they will act. That is, first one is the carbonic anhydrase emitters. Second is osmotic diuretics, which will both will act in the proximal convoluted tubule. Third one is loop diuretics or high ceiling diuretics, which are acting at the thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle. Fourth type is thiazide diuretics, which will act in the distal convoluted tubules. And the next is the potassium sparing diuretics, which will act in the collecting duct. Thank you.